Thank you for this invitation. Let me briefly introduce myself. I'm a sort of historian of information technology. It's also for the age, of course. And for make my living, I work in a company that is System Integrator, a software development company that is highly engaged in Industry 4.0 and artificial intelligence and so on. And again, I do collaborate with Scuola Superiore Sant'Anna on a research project in these topics. So I have the opportunity to have both sides of the views. So I have only a few slides, so I try to speak in 15 minutes, couple of minutes per slide. First of all, the artificial intelligence has a long story. It started many years ago with expert systems, different things, only with a very small niche. Now, why it is so diffused? It is, I mean, on the mouths of everyone, for four reasons. I think the most important one, it is the explosion of data. Now, everyone spoke about the explosion of data in things and so on, the number of bytes per day. So it's for sure the explosion of data requires a different kind of approach in order to be understood, to be analyzed. This kind of explosion has been supported by enhancements in models, enhancement in platforms. Nowadays we have probably four or five different platforms that can be used in order to enable artificial intelligence projects. And I would say also in the decrease of the cost and the enhancement of power in computing. Coming back to my Gartner days, I have to say that I've seen many hypes. I've seen many craziness about technologies. This is the hype cycle for the emerging technologies of Gartner. You see that many of the technologies we are talking about, blockchain, artificial intelligence, and so on, they are almost at the tip of the hype. Usually what happens is that then there is a huge drop, what is called a true disillusionment, and then the plateau of productivity comes later and later on. And usually what happens is that when you arrive at the plateau productivity time, it is very different. So it means that if you adopt something now, you have to experiment, but then you have also to expect that the adaptation process is going to change the way that things they are doing right now. And so it's also important in terms of investment that you are making in some areas. And there are different implications regarding financial sites and so on that it's very difficult to examine in few minutes. There is another important point that in this world of amounts of billions of data, we lack of data. There aren't so many surveys or data collection activities to track what is going on. So many of the decisions are taken on, I mean, guesses or qualitative data or qualitative researches and so on. And I think this is a weakness where this is maybe a place where we should talk about this kind of needs to have more data. There are some serious researches. One has been conducted by OECD, and I'm going to talk about it in a couple of slides. Other by private companies such as McKinsey, or the same by Gartner or IDC or so on. But we're still missing data. And without data, it's very complicated to take the right decisions. I have to say that the web and the internet is producing a lot of data. And these data could be used, they are called alternative data sets. They could be used to support decision making. There are several initiatives in business, mainly in the financial community, that are using this data in order to complement the traditional data that are used by investors in order to take decisions. And I think they should also be used in this kind of decision-making process. Let's go to another couple of topics. First of all, this is just a sample. This is a survey made by the company called SAS. It's one of the major players in analytics at a worldwide level. It is a survey on 500 executives. It's a very small one. Just pick up it as a qualitative survey, not a quantitative one. But what is interesting, it is that this survey confirms what other analyses are saying right now, that AI is going to replace the typical, repetitive tasks. So the one of call center, the one of answering, such as answering on the phone, the first call, these kind of tasks. Some tasks at the ground floor level in manufacturing, it's very difficult that artificial intelligence will replace complicated tasks. What we are seeing right now is applications that are currently be used are those regarding sort of first level dispatching of mails and this kind of application. Another interesting analysis is on who owns artificial intelligence. Pretty clear it is that the patent activity on artificial intelligence has been growing a lot. If you make 100 in 2010, we're about six times now in terms of amount of patents. Then if you look at who is patenting, you see that is mainly the same guys that we know that are performing the majority of the patent activity. You see here Facebook, Google, or Amazon, or Microsoft, that are the key guys that are patenting artificial intelligence. It is very interesting this, as there's no time to go deeper on this, but which kind of activities they are doing on this patenting. Amazon, for instance, is on logistics. Apple is mainly on answering, automatic answering, around Siri and so on. And Google is on machine learning and learning on image and learning on conversations. And this is something that it is exactly the end of what I'm going to say. Recently, McKinsey published a very important study on the impact of labor. OECD published a second one. There are other studies, I think, relevant on both on the private or on the public side. Some of them are also performed by the Department of Labor in the United States. And I just put together a picture. The numbers, do not stick on the numbers. I think the numbers are only to drive a more qualitative discussion. So if you pick up the overall, working population of Western countries, several surveys are saying that 20% of this working population is already engaged in what is called the gig, crowd, platform economy, and so on. We work with Richard Freeman, for instance. He's saying that probably 25 in the United States, probably in Europe we are a little lower. Well, this is something that is highly involved with the digital transformation. It is a new thing. It is a new way of a relationship with labor. It is something that is under investigated. The second important point is the part that is going to be substituted by machine. This kind of repetitive tasks. The recent
survey made on adults by OECD is saying that it's between 10 to 14% in the next 20 years. It is a relevant amount, but it is not 40% of what Frey and Orton were saying about 4 or 5 years ago. What is interesting is that there is a similar percentage of new jobs and professions that are not fulfilled, are not covered. So where we are talking about the new data scientists, about cyber architects, about this kind of new professions, and this is going to be, there is another kind of discussion that should be open regarding the role of education and the way that education can fulfill this kind of new jobs. We know that it's very complicated to find the right people in order to build Industry 4.0 projects or this kind of holistic projects that are not on one machine. They are on many, they are on networks, and you need a different kind of professions. So as we have to see to the jobs that are going to be substituted by machines, same way we have to look at these new professions and the way we have to fill these new professions. But the majority of the big amount, and someone already spoke about this, it is related to the part of jobs that will change for people, men and women, that are probably in their 40s, in their 50s. And work on these changes and help them on these changes is going to be very complicated. More complicated than replace the 10% of jobs that will be substituted by machines. Why? Because these jobs are not pure job substituted jobs by robots or by artificial intelligence, depends on which kind of sector or process you are. It's more because you're going to, there is a need to work with the machines. You have to work with the machines. So you have to change your job profile. So in other terms, there is the need of a huge amount of investment, let's call it this way, in order to support all this change. And do not focus only on the jobs that are going to be substituted. So how to do this? Some of you know, maybe my colleagues at the University of Pisa, that have been studying this concept of unaware workers. I started to study this concept that at the end it's a business model, it's nothing strange. When I reviewing the revenue per employee of the web giants, I saw that they had a revenue per employee that was 4 or 5 times the other ICT companies. So I tried to discover why. So what I saw, what I discovered also working very close to them, is that 30% of the data they produce, by the way, data are their key asset, okay, is built by machines. And these machines do their work, extracting value from the free conversation. So in other terms, we believe that we are receiving a free service, but in other terms we are working for them. And this is it. And I finish here. This means that we can, I mean, bias a different level of web tax, because this is probably a way that where they produce a huge extra profit based on this mechanism. So, long story, not short, long changes, huge amount of investments, and always the ways how to execute it, how to support these changes. Thank you.